details. What can be done about the human rights violations and displacements in Myanmar 1 year after the coup? Joining me today are our Myanmar experts from various organizations. Please allow me to introduce our panelists, starting with Mr. Don Tatsarun Su. He is a human rights activist, researcher, advocacy, and lecturer. Currently, he is a project director at People's Empowerment Foundation, which focuses on strengthening human rights of grassroots and those vulnerables. He has involved in many human rights activism as engaging with international human rights mechanisms, supporting political refugees, or working on peace in Southern Thailand and Myanmar. Mr. Don Tatsarun Su. And next we have Ajahn or Professor Lalita Han Wong from Gesetsa University. Ajahn Lalita is a lecturer in modern Southeast Asian history with an emphasis on Myanmar. She is also a columnist written for media outlets across Thailand, and her weekly column Thai Pok Pama, or Thailand Meets Myanmar, is featured in Mathichon Daily Newspaper every Friday. Next, we have Ms. Roya Rage, who is a senior crisis advisor for Amnesty International. She is tasked with investigating war crimes and human rights abuses in crisis. Her work with Amnesty International has included documenting violations in Myanmar, the Philippines, Syria, Yemen, and South Sudan. And last but not least, we have Gotet Swain Win, who is a human rights activist from Myanmar. He has led numerous campaigns to counter the hate speech, also the Buddhist nationalism and anti-Muslim and anti-Rohingya discrimination and violence. He is also the founder and executive director of Synergy, which is a social harmony organization which seeks to strengthen social cohesion in Myanmar. He is also the recipient of several human rights awards. So for today, each speaker will have around 10 minutes to discuss and talk on specific issues, and I'll be asking questions. And after that, they will give short suggestions and solutions. And then we'll be taking questions and questions from the audience. And without further ado, may I please invite Ms. Roya Rage to give an overview of the findings of the report. Ms. Roya, please.
Thank you very much, everyone, for joining us today. It's such a pleasure to be talking to all of you and to present the findings of the report. At the outset, I would like to begin by telling you the methodology or how we conducted the research, and then I'm going to be going quickly through some of the key or main findings of the report. In terms of the methodology, the research took place between March and April of this year, including a two-week visit, which we undertook along the Thai-Myanmar border. We focused our research on violations that took place between December 2021 and March of this year. We interviewed 99 people. And those people, the vast majority of them, or more than 60, were firsthand witnesses and survivors of attacks and violations. Interviewees also included aid workers, medical workers, as well as defectors from the Myanmar military. We relied not only just on interviews, but we also verified open source material, including photos and videos related to human rights violations. We had colleagues analyze weapons and ammunition for us, satellite imagery, fire data analysis, and we also reviewed open source aircraft observation made by flight spotters on the ground in Myanmar in relation to the movement of aircraft. The focus, the area of the focus, of course, is Eastern Myanmar, specifically Cayenne and Kaya states, as well as bordering areas in Moon and Southern Shan states in relation to the operations primarily in Kaya and Cayenne, or Karen and Karenni. We documented various violations that took place, and those violations range from unlawful attacks on civilians and civilian infrastructure to detention-related violations, to looting and burning. Let me begin by telling you a little bit about the unlawful attacks against civilians and civilian infrastructure. The attacks came both from the air and the ground. And what we documented was essentially two broad patterns. So either the military was indiscriminately indiscriminately firing on civilians and civilian areas in the course of fighting with armed groups, or in many other cases, we documented incidents where the military deliberately targeted civilians and civilian infrastructure, even when there were no military targets in the vicinity of those impacted by the attacks. When it comes, for example, to the attacks that came from the ground, so those are primarily mortar and artillery shelling, we documented specifically 24 such attacks that took place between December 2021 and March of this year. One of such attacks, for example, that really stayed with us from March of 2022 that I want to share with you, involved shelling that fell between two houses in a village in Cayenne State in March of this year. As families were preparing dinner. So two families in two separate houses were preparing dinner. The shelling falls right between the houses and kills seven civilians, including an 8-month pregnant woman. Three other people were injured. One particular detail that really stayed with me from that attack was when a close relative of four of the people who were killed in the attack told me that he spent all night just sitting there looking at the bodies of his four dead relatives, unable to bury them, waiting until the morning to bury them, because he himself feared that if he stepped out to carry out the burial that night, he and others will be injured or impacted in further shelling that went on throughout the night. And this is very much consistent with a lot of the interviews where people told us that those barrages of mortars and artillery shelling at times lasted for hours, even days, nonstop. That same month, another mortar attack that also we documented took place in Moon State, so in March of this year. As people were gathered to celebrate a religious festival, mortars landed on them, killing three people, including two women in their 50s and a seven-year-old boy, and injuring 11 others. So even as people were undertaking a religious festival, this kind of shelling that we saw targeting civilians and causing a mass casualty event. When it comes to airstrikes, our report really underscores the intensification of this type of attack. So we see the Myanmar military stepping up attacks from the air, particularly late at night, hitting both villages and, for example, in one case, we documented a camp for displaced people. And those kind of attacks rely both on legacy systems, those airstrike attacks relying both on legacy systems as well as newer Russian and Chinese made jets. We specifically documented 8 airstrikes that took place between January and March of this year. One attack I want to share with you, for example, took place on the 17th of January in Kaya State, targeting the Rikibu IDP camp, killing a man in his 50s and two girls, two sisters who are 15 and 12 years old. And what people told us, what aid workers told us from that area, is that the location of the camp would have been very clear to the military from the air in any surveillance that this is a displacement site and not a base for armed groups. So once again, a very clear civilian target coming under attack and causing this type of casualty. And just to highlight that this is a displacement site where people had already fled from a horrific incident, the Mosul massacre on Christmas Eve, in which more than 35 people had been, men, women, and children had been stopped by the military, shot and killed, and then burned alive. And so it was survivors from that area that had fled from this camp and then once again coming under attack in such a horrific way. The attacks, both from the air and the ground, not only caused civilian casualties in terms of deaths and injuries of civilians, but also significant damage to civilian infrastructure. So we document a clear pattern of destruction of schools, medical facilities, and houses of worship. For example, when it comes to houses of worship, we documented just firsthand ourselves at least 7 incidents of attacks on religious buildings, 4 that had been attacked by shelling from the ground and 3 by airstrikes. And of course, these are only very small numbers. These are sample numbers to a massive pattern of such attacks. I mean, when it comes to attacks on religious facilities, reports indicate that since the coup, the military had destroyed or damaged more than 100 houses of worship in Kaya State, particularly, for example, 8 churches were destroyed between January and March of this year, according to the Karini Human Rights Group. We also document, for example, 3 attacks on schools and the military's occupation of schools in at least 4 villages. All of this causes mass displacement and a psychological impact that I will be addressing in a later part of this pattern, of this panel, rather. In addition to the attacks on civilians and civilian infrastructure, we also document very clear detention-related violations. So arbitrary arrest, torture and ill treatment, extrajudicial executions and enforced disappearance in the context of these armed operations that are taking place, or these military operations that are taking place by the military. And when it comes to the detention or these unlawful violations, when it comes to detention, they fell within 2 broad patterns. So the detention either targeted the activists, the politician, the members of the civil disobedience movement who had fled from urban areas to escape persecution by military authorities in those urban areas, whether, for example, Yangon or other areas, so they'd fled from these urban areas to the areas controlled by the ethnic armed organizations. So we see a pattern where the military went after them, deliberately trying to arrest them, for example, in Lake Ka in mid-December in Cayenne State, where operations entailed the military going door to door looking for these politicians and activists who In addition to targeting those activists and politicians, then the second pattern targeted the civilians from those areas, the Karen and Karini civilians, on the basis of their ethnicity. And this is not new. We see the military conducting these kind of arrests and detention on the basis of ethnicity, both in these areas in previous operations and in other ethnic areas around the country, because there's a presumption that those civilians are associated or could support the ethnic armed groups. And that particular pattern we see happen time and time again to civilians as they are traveling from displacement sites to collect food, to collect belongings, because many of them had fled their areas with the clothes on their back, and then they're staying in displacement sites, but they need to come out to go back home to collect food, to go to their farms. And it's there where they, along those routes, that they get targeted, that they get detained, tortured, and in some cases disappeared or killed. One particular case that really stays with me dates to January of this year in Kaya State, particularly in Sampia 6 Mile Village, where 3 men had stepped out of their displacement site to go back home to collect food for their families against the advice of their families. This is around January 20th of this year. They go missing for 2 weeks, and it's only on February 3rd that their bodies are found dumped in a pit latrine. They're only able to be identified by their teeth, by their clothes, because of the state of decomposition. And even as their bodies are being retrieved by a family member, the people who are collecting the bodies get shot at and have to escape and are unable to go back and collect their remains until March 23rd. Something that, again, came through time and time again in interviewees, where people are unable to collect the bodies of their loved one and the bodies are just left there to decompose. Many other violations we also documented, including looting and burning, but I'm mindful of the time. And so I will keep that to the second part of my presentation today.
Thank you very much, Laura, for your insight. We are now moving on to Professor Larita and take a look at the, I would say, a bigger pictures of the whole overview of the situation in Myanmar. Professor Larita, could you please give us an overview of the situation in Myanmar since the coup happened in February 2021? What has happened in Myanmar in terms of, for example, the roles of a junta or the national unity government of Myanmar, or the PDF, or even Aung San Suu Kyi?
All right, guys. I have a few pages of PowerPoint presentation here. May I ask some? Yes. Yeah, I just have 3 pages here, I promise, because I don't have so much time. I'm just going to go through what happened, or what has happened, what's happening in Myanmar. Real quick, to think of the scale, how crazy and how bad the situation has become. You know, I'm showing you these casualties so far. There are 2,345 people plus civilians who have been killed by, you know, directly by the junta, or some people have been affected in, well, I guess everyone has been affected directly by the coup and the junta. But some of these casualties, they were killed directly by during different fightings with the regime's forces. And the second statistics I would like to show you is the highest casualties happened in three regions in Myanmar, namely Sagaing, Yangon, and Mandalay. And just keep in mind that these regions are one of the most populated regions in Myanmar. We're talking about Yangon, the region where the former capital city of Myanmar is, and Mandalay, Mandalay region, where Mandalay, the second largest city in Myanmar, is. And then we're talking about Sagaing, which is the center of the resistance, which I'll be talking about that in just a minute. And then we also have 135 civilians under 18 years old who have been killed during these violence, you know, during the last 17 months of violence in Myanmar as well. Now, because I am actually a history teacher, a lecturer, so I would like to proceed to the second page, which is the timeline. For the entire event, I have two pages of this. I have realized that these two pages have not included everything that you know, you need to know. But I have been quite selective, and I have selected a few key moments during the last 17 months that have happened in Myanmar. Now we start with when the coup took place. The 1st of February 2021, you know, it feels like forever. It feels like this coup has happened long, long time ago, but it just happened over a year ago. And on that day, NLD leaders, political activists, and pro-democracy politicians, they were arrested, and other political opponents of the junta have been detained ever since. Now, moving on to the second event, which happened on the 3rd of February 2021, basically just a couple of days after the coup. Now, and the 3rd of February was the day that the very first series of strike happened in Myanmar, starting from round about, well, I don't know exactly the number, but plenty of staff from 70 hospitals and other institutions, they started to strike, and they stopped working. And that's how the civil disobedience movement in Myanmar began. Now, I don't want to stress too much about this, but a lot of you may have known that since the day of the coup, since the 3rd of February, quite a number of people, civil servants, you know, doctors, nurses, teachers, lecturers across the country have been on strike. And just imagine this. I'm not sure if you know how it feels exactly, but since the day of the coup, these people haven't got salary. You know, they haven't been back to their school. They haven't been back to their hospitals. And there have been articles written about them, about this CDM fighters, if you like to call them that way. These guys who have sacrificed their lives and their career, you know, just to show their strong will that, no, we don't want to work with the junta anymore. And we would like to show this solidarity with the rest of Myanmar people across the country. So we don't want to work with the junta whatsoever. And we would like to undermine the junta with every way possible. Moving on to the 9th of February, that's exactly when, you know, the real picture of violence took place, when the very first woman was lethally shot. She was shot in the head, but she died several days later. Her name was Ma Tuy Tuy Khain. 27th of March, 2021, that was the day of the Armed Forces Day in Myanmar. And usually, you know, if you know Myanmar quite well, you know that the Tatmadaw or the Armed Force or the Army, the Myanmar Army, they celebrate the Armed Forces Day like really, really hugely every year. And well, I'm not so sure about this, but there is something about the term Tatmadaw, or, you know, the glorious armed forces of Myanmar. So on that day, there was a big protest, and the junta started to kill civilians who went protest on the street. So on that day alone, 160 people were killed. 16th of April, 2021, NUG, or the National Unity Government, was formed. Now, just to give you a bit of background, because I presume that many people are on this forum, on this webinar right now, you don't really have, you don't know too much about Myanmar or what was going on then. NUG, as we call them all the time, NUG, we don't even refer to them as National Unity Government anymore, it's just NUG. This is what we call the parallel government of Myanmar. They are led by political activists, they are led by former politicians, parliamentarians, and you know, the large number of NUG members. Their movement is outside of Myanmar right now. So members of NUG include ousted parliamentarians, activists, so on and so forth. Next page, please. Okay, the 5th of May, 2021, Daw Aung San Suu Kyi appeared for the first time in court since the day of the coup. So it's been what, February, March, April, May. So it's been around about 4 months, you know, to take the junta, to take her to the court. 24th of May, 2021, PDF force formed. Now, in Myanmar, when you talk about armed resistance, when you talk about ethnic armed organizations, usually they have one political wing, and they have the armed wing. Okay, it's exactly the same with NUG/PDF. All right, PDF is People's Defense Force. Okay, I'll be real quick here. So PDF was formed, and they became armed wing of NUG. The 16th of October, 2021, Min Aung Hlaing was excluded from ASEAN Summit. If I have time, I would like to talk about this point later on during the second round. And during his not visit, his non-appearance during this ASEAN Summit, ASEAN released this, you know, pretty notorious, well, not notorious, but I would say useless, 5-point consensus, which was launched in April. I'm sorry, I'm a bit confused. This 5-point consensus was launched in April, and Min Aung Hlaing was actually there. 7th of January, 2022, Hun Sen, the Prime Minister of Cambodia, as the chairman of ASEAN this year, visited Myanmar, but it was in vain as well. And finally, in June 2022, we have all heard of this sad news that the junta announced execution of two political prisoners, namely Go Jimmy and Pyo Zeya Daw, who is actually my favorite rap and hip hop singer of all time. Okay, I've concluded here, and I'll see you again during the second round. I hope that you have seen some overview before we continue to hear more insights from other speakers.
Adelaide, I have one question. Yeah. Could you enlighten us on the difference between this time of the coup and the coup in the past of Myanmar, please?
The coup in the past of Myanmar, like in 1988, 1962.
Yeah. This time and previous times.
To be honest, it's a very complicated question. And I don't have a definite answer for this, mm-hmm. but I would say that the present coup happened out of, you know, fear, out of paranoia of just about everything, you know, and out of hatred and simply paranoia of the former civilian government led by the National League of Democracy or Daw Aung San Suu Kyi. But if you talk about, you know, the most famous coup, the most notorious coup of 1962, that was led by General Ne Win. I think the coup was undertaken from the personal perspective. And but I'd like to say that these two coups are quite similar as well. You know, excuses that they use, both Ne Win and Min Aung Hlaing use, are exactly the same, in my opinion. It's like, you know, we would like to crush everyone who would like who give our country instability. We would mm-hmm. like to crush anyone who would torn Myanmar apart and things like that. You know, so it's pretty much the same thing, and I don't want to emphasize so much further that in the mind of you know, army officers, army leaders in Myanmar, nothing has changed since the day of independence, say 1947, 1948. You know, the military academy in Phin Uy Win or in Mae Myo, exactly the same mindset, exactly the same people, and they haven't changed because they can't. If you want to think differently, you would be ousted, you know, you would be ignored by your comrades, by your friends and your colleagues. So it's not possible at all for people in the military in Myanmar to think differently.
Thank you so much for your answer. And now let's move on to the Thailand and Myanmar border with Khun Don. Khun Don, as a person who has worked on refugee issues, could you please give us the overview of the Myanmar refugee situation in Myanmar-Thailand border, including, you know, the current conditions of the refugee camps before and after the coup? Have you seen like the influx of refugees, or what is really going on at the border?
Okay, yeah, good evening, everyone. My name is Don Noh. I'm working at the border for humanitarian assistance after the coup occurring. So I will share the screen now. Okay. Okay, if you go quite fast because we have just only 10 minutes. So at least I would like to emphasize that, you know, in Thailand, actually they have so many refugees coming to Thailand, but what I would like to tell you that actually, you know, Thailand send back refugees go to the original country, like it's happened in the Cambodian refugee and also Uyghur, you know. So what I want to emphasize that because Thailand is not the safe place for refugee, but yeah, Thailand also have many refugee in the country right now. And then you can see, you know, like the first group refugee from Myanmar, I mean the huge influx of the refugee is started on 1988. I haven't born yet that time. And it come up with the 9 refugee camp along the borders. And I'm not sure about the number of the person in the camp. It's like estimate about 90,000. And then after that, we also have the Rohingya crisis 2007. And then the lastly, the coup 2021 coup, you know, it's like the refugees also across the border to Thailand. So as I mentioned before, no, after the 1988, it's like we have the outcome of that refugee camp in Thai size. And also have, after this situation, also have many NGO were extubated along the border for help people inside Myanmar. Like many NGO working on health issues, child protections, medical service, education inside and along the borders. And since that time until now, NGOs became the key actor, you know, to provide basic need to the people. And because of that incident, there's also have increasing number of the migrant workers in Thailand. So I would like to wrap up about the 2021 coup. You can see, what I will mention next, you know, is based on my experience, my analysis. Now, so what I got that is like the CDM people start crossing the border since March, April, in along the borders, and then we went to the borders to with our stakeholders, and then to try to support them at the beginning, and then we keep going every month, and NGOs. After coup, you know, many NGO cannot go inside the Myanmar side. It's quite more difficult for them to go. And then the big incident is about December 2021, like mentioned before, the Lake Gekko fighting, you know, it's like around 4,000 people displaced and then crossing to Thai side. And I would like to give you overview about when they're crossing to the Thai side. You know, you can see when you're crossing the border to Thai side, normally you are undocumented because Thailand do not recognize refugee status, do not recognize the international norm of refugee. So people have to survive, you know, under these conditions. Some people crossing back because of difficult situation here in Thai side, but some still saying without legal protections. And, you know, somehow they have to pay monthly to local authorities for protections. Usually it's about 10 US per month. And someone is like applied for white card, like to stay in Thailand for 10 years. And someone can apply for refugee and resettlement to another country. But during the Lake Gekko's, you know, it's like all people in after the Lake Gekko fightings, they have to fight back in 72 hours, according to the Thai policy. It just overview what happened with refugee when they crossed the border to Thai side. And this one I want to show that it's like, it is the local authorized caste, you know, as you are undocumented, it's like when some people get authorized by local officers, like they have to pay about, sorry, it's the missed number, it's about 10 US a month, they have to pay for local authorities, and they will not get arrested under this card. And some people apply for white card on the left, you know, they can live in Thai around 10 years, but they could not go crossing the border. I mean, crossing to the another province, they have to be stuck in the like the border area. And it is the, you know, as like people don't get much support from the government side, you know, so it's like the food, anything is like have to distribute along the borders. It's like a lot of the Thai borders, this thing happened. Local communities, local NGOs became the key actors like to support people in IDP site by sending food, you know? And then this is what happened from IDP inside. I get photo from our friend inside camp now. Then they say inside IDP camp, it's like the situation is going worse, you know, because like people cannot get access much food. And also you see it's like not much water for them. It's like some people living on the mountain, you know, it's like they could not get much water. So we try to send stuff as much as we can to them every month. And then this happened along the borders. They have many establishments of the local education. It's not the formal education, but anyhow, they have many students, many the organizations like promote education to the children along the borders. And you know, after the incidents of the coup, it's like the number of students is like increasing over time. It's like it just the last number you can see is like right this year is about 15,000 students want to enroll to this education, just only one school. And many schools also have the high number of students, but now and then many of students also turn to study online. Okay, let's go to the next. And then after Lake Gekko fightings, you know, some people when they crossing the border, they went to the camp by the under authorized by government, but some people also living in the village. So we have seen that many Thai village also help many local refugee around the borders. And you know, some organizations in NGOs, organizations try to help the refugee and CDM to have the job along the borders, like they have the job training for to teach them, you know, to can go to work at the factory in Mesot. Because at the long term, CDM or VV refugee is not, it's not easy for them to live without like economic sustainable. And then this thing is like during the Lake Ekor fighting, you can see that they have some 4,000 villages, right, living in the Mekok work camp under government's authorized. And then after that, many people like left, going back from the camp, going back and then cross back again. But actually, you can see on the left side, left on the top, is it the camp is called the No Man Land, you know, because people living in the rivers, because during one season, it's like the water rising down. So it's like people stay at the national borders. According to this term, for me, it's like people not crossing to Thai side, they're just living on national borders under the rivers. And then as we visit them, you know, they can organize themselves. They know how to organize themselves. Many staff from here, they took it from the Myanmar side. And you see along the border, you can see the camp line is actually, along the border, you can see this camp, water camp. And this one is like the one project, no, we support the IDP camp inside. We provide them the seed, and then they can grow up the seed inside IDP, you know. Yeah, for me, it's like after the coup, like people still struggle from like the basic needs, you know, like food, education, shelters. This is things still happen along the borders. And then for us, like NGO, we don't know like what is the long-term solutions to support them. But what we can do now, just provide humanitarian support, you know, as much as we can. And we also have many international friends to support these issues. Okay, I think for me, I will stop here for the first sections. And the second section, I will mention about local Thai government for the next one. Thank you. How to?
Thank you very much, Khun Don, for your presentation, ka. And now we are moving on to Go Tet Sui Win Mingla Vashin. Go.
Okay, Mingla Vakamya.
Okay, Ago, my question to you would be, after the coup in 2021, how have the Myanmar activists or civil societies handled with the ongoing situation and the mass displacements? Could you tell us the difficulties, the challenges you have confronted?
Yeah, hello everyone and very good evening. After the coup, actually, like, you know, we, the people fighting and some of the political groups, we already got the information and we already, predicted that the coup will happen, you know, phone. For like, we also had some sort of preparation among us, among the activists and among the political forces. So, but that is also why, you know, that, you know, the military, arrested, you know, many activists and politicians, you know, at the first day of the coup, because they knew that we are also planning something to do that, to counter it. So on the 3rd of February, that, you know, since before the 3rd of February, you know, many youth groups have organized, you know, many small protests and like, you know, kind of, you know, flash mobs, you know, in the public area. So like, we started doing this kind of campaigns, and also like, we actually got weak to counter the fam misinformation, because, you know, after the coup, you know, we got a rumor on the social media saying that, you know, if everyone keeps quiet for 3 days, then the coup is not successful. So then like the kind of message spread, you know, on the social media, everyone got quiet. So like when we, you know, like, you know, mobilize people to do something, that we will be labeled, you know, as a, you know, traitor, or, you know, like, you know, as a, you know, somebody from the, you know, military fight, you know, this kind of narrative, you know, spread around. So we couldn't, you know, change the narrative. So that is why, you know, many of the young people, even though they wanted to fight back, but, you know, they only, you know, make it as a, you know, anonymous. But on the 3rd of February, you know, then all the coup, that all the, you know, the protest started in the country. And then after that, you know, a bigger movement happened. So, you know, the civil society, we actually grew, you know, a lot, you know, during the back in the 10 years time, like during the, you know, partial, you know, democratic, you know, era, that, you know, the civil society, you know, grew a lot. And then we are well connected across the country. This is also one of the strand of the Spring Revolution, because like in the former coup, in the previous coup, we did not have, you know, such kind of, you know, civil society network and no social media at all. So we could not communicate and, you know, connect each other. But this time, we already have established network among the civil society groups and activists. And also the social media helps us a lot, you know, to connect and communicate with the people. So we could do a lot, you know, to mobilize many of the nonviolent movements, you know, until, you know, the self-defense, you know, revolutionary, until we step forward to the self-defense stage. So these are like, you know, many of the civil societies were like responding in many different ways. Of course, we had a lot of difficulties. So even for me, on the 6th of February, the first day of the protest in Yangon, the military raided my house, because like I joined the protest in the Yangon, at the first protest in Yangon, and I gave an interview to some of the international media. So, and then like then on that day, they cut off the internet again. So, you know, only a few interviews, you know, went on air, you know, so then they were spotted me, and then that they raided my house again on that day. But luckily, like I was really like moving around, so staying around, so they couldn't find me. Then they started, you know, arresting people, you know, to all of the like kind of well-known activists that who they see as you know, the main target at the time. And many of my friends got arrested. But, you know, after the, but we, during the coup, like what we were talking about was like, you know, nonviolence, you know, especially this is one of the failure of the civil societies in Burma, that we were like kind of, many of us were kind of nonviolent. But, you know, when the state attacking the acts, then we had to like, you know, to defend ourselves. And many of the activists and civil societies, you know, so they also, you know, turn into, you know, some of the what is it, the defense group, like, you know, for example, one of the well-known activists called Mang Fongka, now he turned himself into a leader of the BPLA. BPLA is called Burma People Liberation Army. So like this kind of, you know, movement also happened, you know, from the human rights defenders and from the civil society groups. So many of the civil society leaders nowadays, especially in the Sakai and Magway regions, so they are leading in the defense, like, you know, in the defense, what is it, military things, so they are leading it. And some of the protest groups, they are also doing a lot of protest, you know, despite of, you know, having a lot of difficulties and dangers. So many young people inside the country got arrested. Even 2 days ago, my friend, my very good friend, called, like, but I don't want to say his name. So he and his wife, they were very well-known activists. They did not hide. And my friend, the guy, he got arrested, and along with his 2-year-old son. So his son actually has the, what is it, the lactose intolerance. So, but, you know, they actually kept him in the detention. And then when the grandparents, you know, went to the police station and asked for the kids, they said they went to exchange with his mother. the baby's mother, because she is also a well-known activist. So they, this is like kind of, the baby is being held as a hostage just 2 days ago by the Burmese police. But luckily that, you know, that from UN and the embassy gave pressure to the police. And then yesterday evening, the baby got was released. But my friend is still in the prison, like they still arrest him. And also last week, about 30 underground protesters in Yangon got arrested, you know. So the situation in the human rights defenders and the protesters in the cities is really unsafe now, because people are very scared. I mean, like they don't, because like if they got, if they arrested, you know, some of the, you know, protester at one house, the house owners will also be arrested. So they did not rent the houses, you know, to the young people. And then also for the transportation, you know, the taxi or like the car rental, they don't want to rent it to the, you know, unknown young people. So like the saturation of the human rights defenders and also the activists in the cities are very, very vulnerable nowadays. And then they need a lot of attention and protection. But sadly, we still cannot afford, or we still cannot support them as much as we could, that, you know, especially for the safe houses or the transportation or, and et cetera. Because, you know, even though if we provide one safe house for them, you know, they cannot stay there for a long time. They have to move around, you know, depends on the security. But, you know, we do not have plan, you know, for them to rent several houses. So we only have one house for them, that they stay there for like several months. And then, you know, when things happen, you know, they are quite desperate to move to the other place, but, you know, we can't, you know, help them. So by that way, many activists got arrested. And for some people like me, you know, like, you know, I personally escaped, you know, things last year, March, middle of March, you know, after they raided my office again. So like, I had no, you know, no chance to stay in the city. Then I decided to move to the ethnic area. And I stayed in the Karen state for 7 months, around 7 months. And then I fled to the border town. So the place where I'm in right now is also having a lot of problems, because, you know, as Pete Don said, that, you know, the, like, you know, after the Lekego attack and after the, you know, the coup, like about 40,000 of, you know, refugees just, you know, came into Thailand, especially to the border towns. So like many thousands of newcomers here, then they got a lot of problems, especially with the local authorities, that, you know, many people got arrested every day. And then even today, like I just actually came back from the police station, that, you know, one of my friends got arrested. So like I had to deal with the police to release him. But like this kind of cases happen every day. And then we have no protection for the refugees in the border town, and then no proper mechanisms to protect, you know, the refugees here yet. So that is also a big challenge, that, you know, and many people got, you know, the problems of their livelihood, because like they, many people are the CDMers, that they have no job. And then, you know, for example, like, you know, some teachers, they are working at the construction now. You know, so because they have no job, because in the border town, you know, we only have a few job opportunities here. So they couldn't, you know, get, you know, their a professional job here. So they are just, you know, taking any home, you know, jobs that they get. So, and also by that way, the wage, the daily wage is also getting lower. So they only get about 150 to 200 baht per day, you know, for their hard labor work. So this kind of problems are also happening, and many people are like having, what is it, depressions and anxiety, like, because they have no, they feel like they have no future, I mean, in the border town. And inside the gantry, like as you all might hear about it, that, you know, the death penalty for the four activists, that is also a big, you know, challenge for us, that, you know, they are like threatening to the activists that they could do it, you know. So it's really worrying. And also the Federation that, you know, that Hunter is trying to bring the Federation back to the normal. They feel like, you know, they are trying to show off to the world that the Federation is, you know, getting normal. And they're opening bars and nightclubs and everything. But in reality, that is not true. But, you know, their media are portraying that, you know, that things are going back to the normal. And they are dragging everything for the next year elections. That, you know, even last week, you know, they are now started taking the, what is it, the statistic, you know, for the elections, for the voter list. So they started taking the voter list since last week. So they are preparing for the elections. But in the other hand, you know, they keep, you know, arresting people, and also they keep, you know, like, you know, fighting to the, you know, ethnic groups and like also to the PDF. And the last but not least, I also would like to mention about the potential human trafficking to the border lines. So that is also one big issue here, because, like, you know, many people hear that, you know, that, you know, they can go to the third country, like to the US or to the Australia. Then they did not get any information, and they did not get any enough information. So like the broker say that, you know, they can go to the US within 2 weeks or within 2 months. Then they take, you know, a big amount of money, like, you know, about 1,000 UFD to 3,000 UFD. Then they bring people in here to Mayfair, and then they just let them stay here in Mayfair, and then they did not do anything. So they are like about more than 100 of people that I had that, you know, that having this kind of problems, that, you know, they paid a lot of money just to apply for the asylum application to the UN. So, but, you know, there is no such any, you know, prevention or measurement, you know, in Mayfair yet. This is like also a big problem here, you know, along the way, along the border. Yeah, so this is like just for my update for the first round.
Thank you very much for sharing your personal experience with us today. Before we move on to another round of talks or discussions, please allow me to summarize what we have discussed so far from each panelist. We started with Ms. Broya, who shared her findings of the report on the bullets rained from the sky, war crimes and displacement in eastern Myanmar, where she mentioned about the types of the attacks on the civilians and numbers of the attacks to the civilians, the unlawful violations, as well as the detentions of politicians and civilians, as well as the number of casualties. And Ajahn Larita mentioned about the timeline of what happened in Myanmar after February 2021, and also the formation of the National Unity Government, or the NUG, or as we know as the parallel government, and the formations of the People Defense Forces, or the PDF, which is people forming the forces to fight back the junta. And also she mentioned about, she shared the difference between the previous coup and this current coup. And Khun Don mentioned about the situation of the refugee camps and how the local NGOs are supporting the refugees and the IDP camps, and how after the coup, the people are still lacking of basic necessities. And Goldet, our last panelist, shared with us his personal experience that the military are still arresting the activists, and he shared about the strength of the civil societies where the activists form network through social media, and how the network got quite like tightened. And then how that the military raided his house and his office, his friends got arrested, and many turned to be the forces or went to the jungle, and some activists are still protesting, and they still need supports, and a lot of them have to move around. And he also shared about that there is no protections for the refugees. And right now, the current situation is that the junta is trying to normalize the situation in Myanmar, like opening doors for tourists and businesses. However, there are still attacks, and you know, like attacks to the an arrest for the activists. And also he also mentioned about the last issue on human trafficking at the border. That's something that it has been an issue recently. So these are some of the topics that we that our speakers have shared in the first round of discussions. So if you have any questions, please feel free to you know, write to us, and we will be taking all your questions and ask our speakers after the finish of the discussion. So let me move on to the another second round of the discussions, where Ms. Roya will first share with us the details of the findings of the report. And you know, Ms. Roya, and how does the unlawful attacks caused the mass displacement in Myanmar or even to the border? And could you explain the current humanitarian crisis as such as the obstructions of aid or the unsafe condition in Myanmar, the effects of the attacks or the displacement on the civilians? Ms. Roya, please.
Thank you, Nati. So in my previous remarks, I spoke to you about the attacks, the unlawful attacks on civilian and civilian infrastructure, as well as the unlawful deprivation and of liberty and associated violations such as enforced disappearance and torture and extrajudicial executions. All of these violations have directly contributed to mass displacement in Kaya and Kayan states and deepening of the humanitarian crisis there. One main bucket of violations I haven't addressed yet and I want to share with you is the looting and burning of villages. We documented a systematic pattern by Myanmar military soldiers of looting, such as taking cash, clothes, vehicles, and livestock from the villages that they have raided. And then it's not just that they were only looting and taking stuff with them as part of their operations, they were deliberately causing destruction to further harm the civilian population. So for example, one civilian told us very clearly how many civilians rather, that they were slashing rice sacks, for example, and destroying these crucial resources for the community. In the words of one of the women we interviewed from Kayan State, she told us that they essentially destroyed what they couldn't take. Not only were they looting these key resources and belongings of civilians, they were also deliberately burning homes. And so we document a pattern, for example, in Kaya State that comes through very clearly from satellite imagery, from the analysis of fire data. For example, in one of the worst hit areas in Kaya State, we see through satellite imagery a road, the road from Mobye to Demoso. Between February and March, as soldiers, Myanmar soldiers moved down along that route, destruction in every single village that they passed through, burning of houses in every single village that they passed through. One particularly hit area, Wari Supply Village, for example, which was attacked on 18th of February, the soldiers there ended up destroying two-thirds of the structures in that village. More than 250 homes were burned in that village, which came through very clearly, not just from the interviews. We interviewed four civilians from that village, but also from the satellite imagery. One man I interviewed shared with me, telling me, my house was destroyed within minutes, all of my life savings, nothing is left of it, just black and charcoal. So a very clear picture of that deliberate punishment of civilians. And what I want to say here is that those unlawful attacks, this unlawful deprivation of liberty, the looting and the burning, all of these are war crimes. And in our analysis, they are also likely crimes against humanity, just because of the nature of how widespread and systematic they are. None of these actions are new. We've seen the Myanmar military carry out this very deliberate pattern of the signature policy of collective punishment against civilians that are perceived to be supportive of ethnic armed groups. And then in this also context of the aftermath of the coup, supportive of the wider protest movement. So what we're seeing here is this signature policy of collective punishment come through and through. And as we said, And as the other speakers spoke of the impact of this is that we end up seeing mass displacement. People spoke of being terrified of running for their lives because they can no longer stay in their villages. It's not just one displacement that we have seen. For many of these people now, these attacks have been going on since last year. And as one of the speakers said, it's been only 1 year, but it feels like it's been happening forever. And that is exactly the feeling of people who have been on multiple displacement over just 1 year. And in Kaya State, for example, we see estimates range between a half to a third to up to a half of the population of the entire state being displaced as a result of this fighting. I believe the overall figures in Kaya and Kayen states is that more than 200,000 people have been displaced, which everybody believes is really an undercount of the actual figures. And people are afraid of going to displacement sites, right? Because they go to camps and then these camps end up being attacked. So they end up hiding further and further in very unsafe conditions in caves, in the jungle, which makes it even harder for humanitarian assistance, the very little humanitarian assistance that is available to be delivered to these civilians. One case, for example, that really stayed with me, we interviewed a woman who had fled after her village had come under attack in Kaya State to a church. They take refuge in a church in May of 2021. That church ends up being attacked. Her mother ends up being killed. So now she has to move to a displacement camp in Kaya State. Many of the people who we spoke to who live in these displacement sites spoke of lack of food, lack of water, definitely lack of access to any medical care, and both physical medical care as well as psychosocial support. This is something that came through again and again in interviewees. These are areas that have very minimal, if any, or actually no support when it comes to mental health and psychosocial support. All of these needs are only going to get more and more and worse with the rainy season. And what is happening is that the military is further causing a deterioration of this humanitarian crisis because of its pattern of obstruction when it comes to humanitarian assistance. So what we're seeing is civilians fearing to move across the roads, so it's difficult for them to access aid. Aid workers as well being targeted, whether deliberately as part of the attacks on civilians or where they're stopped and obstructed at checkpoints. And it's not just the obstruction or the fear of movement to deliver aid, but at times there's also active obstruction, such as the military seizing medical supplies at checkpoints. So we documented that where, the minimal aid convoys that are moving around are being stopped and the military seizing medical supplies at these checkpoints. We also documented incidents such as, for example, in November of 2021, where the military raided a clinic in Loiko town, arrested the medical staff, forcibly transferred the patients, held the medical staff overnight until their release was negotiated. So these kind of actions also further the humanitarian crisis, because then people are afraid to go to medical facilities, are afraid to access care when and where it's needed. So a very clear pattern of obstruction and causing further deterioration to the humanitarian crisis. A very clear need for humanitarian aid to be stepped up and to cooperate with the national organizations on the ground in these areas to come up with innovative ways to see how civilians who are further and further in the jungle and in the caves can be accessed to deliver that much needed assistance to.
Thank you very much, Ms. Roya, for sharing the details of the report. Just out of my curiosity, Ms. Roya, what kind of difficulties that you and your team have experienced during the process of collecting data for this report?
Well, of course, as many of the speakers described, the situation is very fluid on the ground, and civilians have moved further and further into areas of displaced and that makes it very hard to access them for interviews. But we worked very closely with human rights groups on the ground, with national groups on the ground that helped us and supported us in reaching civilians. At times, civilians walked up to several hours to be able to reach an area where they can access communications in a safe and secure way to be able to speak to us. So while we spoke to the civilians who were able to flee and cross into Thailand, those were predominantly, as many of the speakers said, members of the civil disobedience movement, politicians and activists who had the ability to make that trip or to cross. But many civilians are really in hard to reach areas. And we tried very hard to have a representative sample and to reach those civilians to make sure that their voice came through. And we're very indebted to the wide network of aid workers on the ground who helped us and supported us in reaching those civilians to ensure that their voices come through in the report, despite the security situations and the difficulty logistically.
Yeah, thank you very much. I think it's very important that show the voices of the people on the ground. We show the situation of people on the ground, and we make a lot of people aware of the situations that is really going on in the ground. Thank you so much for your hard work and contributions for this. Thank you. We're moving on to Professor Lalitha. Ajahn Ta, สวัสดีค่ะ. Hello. Okay. So in the second round, I'm not sure if you have seen the news recently that the junta meeting with the a lot of the ethnic groups. I'm not sure what's the implication of that. What are they trying to do? What do they hope to achieve with this?
I think it has always been the model for peace talk, or the so-called Pang Long, the Pang Luang spirit. When you talk about peace talk in Myanmar, it's always like you select a few ethnic organizations that you can talk to, and then you just put them in a conference room, you talk to them, and you tell the press, you know, you have some pictures, and you say that, hey, everything is all right, we are holding the peace talk, and there will finally be peace in Myanmar. You know, we've seen this during the NLD government before. We've seen this time and time again during SPDC SLOC era even. And now it's history is now repeating itself, and we are going back to, you know, the model of a faux peace talk, if you like to call it that way. Yeah.
Okay, and what is the directions the Myanmar is moving to, really? Oh,
you know, maybe some people would complain that I always don't have answers, because I really don't have answers to this. If anyone has answers to this, you know, by all means, please share your answers. You know, civil war in Myanmar has happened long time ago, since 1947, 1948, the first days that Myanmar got independence. And now the civil war, it seemed to stop, it seemed to pause a little bit, it seemed to be you know, getting a bit better during the civilian government, but now it's getting worse and worse. So personally, my personal view is quite simple. I see the situation in Myanmar right now is pretty desperate, to be very honest with you. There is one thing that I can say for sure. Pretty much everyone wants this violence to stop. And everyone agrees that, you know, some sort of serious dialogue between the junta, between EAOs, between, you know, other armed organizations, these counterparts, they have to talk, they have to establish some sort of serious dialogue with each other. And that needs to happen right now. I would like to give you an example of myself. I've been interviewed, I've been approached basically by an international organization foundation. They asked me one simple question that you are now asking me. So what would be the solution? What would be the way to go for this violence to finish? And this organization, interestingly, they tried to mediate peace talk in Myanmar. I don't think that they have approached the junta yet, because that would be the most difficult one. But they have been trying to establish connections between, you know, NUG, between counterparts, both inside and outside of Myanmar. And there is always reference to, you know, negotiations to end apartheid in South Africa, lessons learned during the end of Augusto Pinochet's era in Chile, you know, how the genocide in Rwanda ended and things like that. You know, so there have been quite a lot of people who are trying to do this. But I'd like to point out one thing, that the political crisis in Myanmar that we're now facing is probably the most complex one in the world. It is indeed the longest civil war that we have ever seen in our lifetime. And as I said before, it broke out the very first days since Myanmar got independence from Britain. And personally, I think that there are way too many actors. There are way too many EAOs, ethnic armed organizations, you know, and these organizations, they don't have one clear goal, you know. Even if they are ethnic, it doesn't mean that they have to have just one goal in mind. You know, some people would say ethnic armed organizations, oh, everyone wants to topple this regime. Everyone hates this regime, but it's not like that. There are certain ethnic organizations that, you know, can negotiate and can talk amicably with the junta, because all they want is they just want the junta to leave them alone. And, you know, there are tons of examples like that. We can talk about the WAS, we can talk about, you know, some other ethnic groups that have profited greatly from civil war, you know? So that's why peace talk in Myanmar is a very, very difficult question. It's a very difficult thing to do. And we have seen so many examples of failed peace talks before. And as I said before, this is the model, you know, it's a stereotype of peace talk in Myanmar. The junta, the civilian government alike, they want to hold a peace talk, but they decided to hold peace talks only with organizations, ethnic armed organizations that they can talk to, that can respond to what they need, you know. But with really, really active organizations, right now, we can talk about AA or Arakan Army, you know, who is extremely active, and PDF, of course, that is active. And I don't see any possibility that PDF would surrender soon, even if I think last Wednesday or last Thursday, there was a plea, there was a sort of request, there was a press conference by the junta spokesperson, mm-hmm. that mentioned that, hey, let's come to the talk, let's negotiate, we can get through this together, we can talk, and things like that. And we will see this request, you know, this pleas over and over again in the future. Why? Number one, because I think that the junta is now scared of what's going to happen in the future. You know, PDF is quite small compared to the Tatmadaw, but they're quite strong, and the willing to fight is very strong. And I'm pretty sure that this fighting will continue. It will go on for a very, very long time in the future. And number two, I've heard from some sources that say, you know, there's so many deserted soldiers from the Tatmadaw, meaning that soldiers don't want to work with the Tatmadaw or the Myanmar army anymore. So what's going to happen in the future is that now the junta is scared. They fear that they will lose. but they will do anything possible to make sure that they don't lose. But coming back to the negotiation, to peace talk, is it going to happen? I don't think it's going to, it's not, I don't think that it's going to happen anytime soon. I think that PDF doesn't want to talk. You know, the people have lost so much. 1,700 lives or more have been lost by this useless coup, if I may say so. So how can PDF or NUG is going to surrender? I don't see that possibility in short term at all.
Okay, I got asked a lot by the Myanmar enthusiasts about Aung San Suu Kyi, because you know it was just her birthday, 77th birthday, and we still don't know where she is, probably in Naypyidaw. What is going to happen to Aung San Suu Kyi?
I just don't know. I really, really don't know what's going to happen to her. I think the best thing for the junta, you know, is just to silence her. Just make her disappear. I don't mean to be too negative about this, but I'm just saying that the junta would wish that her name would be forgotten by Myanmar people. But I don't think that that would be the case. I don't think that Myanmar people will forget about her. But in my personal view, I think that the struggle for the second independence, let's put it that way, can proceed, can continue without her. You know, now, because of so many restrictions and NLD leaders and pro-democracy activists, a lot of them have been jailed now. So I think it's the matter of time. It's the great matter for younger generations to lead this protest and to lead this activism for Myanmar. Aung San Suu Kyi would always be when I say this, there would be some sort of argument. You know, she did something bad. You know, she didn't even fight for the Rohingyas. She, you know, she even violated human rights and things like that. I don't want to mention that right now because it's not what we're talking about exactly. But for a lot of Myanmar people, she will always become the greatest democratic icon of all time. Mm-hmm. And it's very easy, you know, to when we worship, when we respect just one person, it's mm-hmm. like in India, no matter what, no matter how notorious Mahatma Gandhi is, there are some newer arguments, you know, that Mahatma Gandhi was racist and things like that. But still, you see millions of Indians who worship Mahatma Gandhi and still see him as the greatest icon for the independence of India. So I think Aung San Suu Kyi would be on par with Gandhi in that sense in Myanmar as well.
Mm-hmm. Okay. In your previous, talks, you mentioned about the ASEAN consensus, the 5 points. Do you think that the actions or pressure from the you know international communities will help Myanmar in some sort of sense?
Okay. Now I'm getting pretty desperate, and many people have asked me about that as well. On Sunday, I was in a lecture with a senior Thai journalist who had lots and lots of experience in Myanmar. Mm-hmm. And he said that, hey, don't despair. Don't think that the Thai government or the Ministry of Foreign Affairs doesn't do anything for Myanmar or doesn't care about human rights. And I just, you know, in my mind, I laughed and I giggled a little bit because I seriously think that the Thai government doesn't want to take part in this. The Thai government doesn't want to make the Myanmar junta believe that the Thai government cares about human rights or tries to undermine the Myanmar junta. So in terms of ASEAN, as I said earlier, I think that the 5-point consensus is a bit useless. How could it be useless? Because the junta didn't obey, didn't comply with the 5-point consensus, which makes sense to me because nobody can force the Myanmar junta to do anything really. You know, we've seen from the past, we have experienced before, these guys in green suits, in green military suits in Myanmar, they sit down in their huge rooms in Naypyidaw, and they would never ever let anyone, especially foreigners, to dictate them what to do, you know? Mm-hmm. And for these people, it's a very sensitive issue to say that, hey, you have to do this and that, because it's the way human rights goes. Because first of all, they never believe in human rights. They think that, they even think that it's a Western concept. And mm-hmm. these guys, because they are extreme nationalists, you know, so they're always suspicious. And yeah, they always have fear and paranoia with Westerners. So anything that has this Western sense, you mm-hmm. know, ASEAN in a way is a Western sense. You know, you collect these 10 countries and you tell member states what to do and things like that. I don't think that the Myanmar junta loves that. And in Myanmar, in Burmese language, there is a saying, you know, that people keep saying all the time, the Bobby. Whatever you, and the Bobe means, well, I don't know what it means exactly, but it just means whatever you do, just you know, just do it, but we don't care. Mm. You know, and that is the Burmese way of doing things. That's why during Ne Win's coup, you know, a few years after the coup, Ne Win established the Burmese ways to socialism. Do you remember? Mm. And you know, there is always Burmese way to blah, 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 everything. They don't believe in Western concepts. They don't believe in anything that is invented by someone else, you know, because they know and they think that it's not applicable to the Myanmar case. And they, as the owner of the junta, the Tatmadaw, as the owner of the country, they know what to do. And there is only way that Myanmar can succeed and continue. Myanmar has to be under their spell and their control.
Thank you so much, Azan Lalita, for your answers. We are now, we talk about the Thai government. We mentioned, Lalita mentioned a little bit on the Thai government now. Kun Don Ka, next question is to you. How has the Thai government handled the refugee crisis, and how could the local and international NGO or international organizations can help Myanmar?
Okay, first of all, I would like to explain that, you know, Thai government never say clearly what they explicitly say about refugees along the borders. Even I think many people also asking, no, what is government's policies, provision want to do with refugee? But I think no one get clear answers like what really Thai government want to do. So I would like to share a bit a slide. Then this is also come from my analysis as well. So I will give like the basic summary of the role of Thai government. First is ignore international norm in collaboration from international communities and join hand with the daily aware on relationship with Myanmar governments and crossing eye, you know, it's like actually local activists, the local actors, they still can distribute humanitarian aid to the along the borders, but it seems like government do not allow, but they didn't see it. This thing happens. It's like they just ignore what, just crossing eye, you know, and then let local people actors doing these things. And it is come from my analysis. Now it's like I try to understand what is Thai government thinking, so what is they thought about it. So let's go back to the UPR's report in 2021. It's like in the report, you know, Thailand on the sections of refugee, Thai governments don't use the word refugees. And then they use the word of people of concern based on the UN definitions. And because of this definition, it means Thai government do not want to, how do I say, do not want to recognize refugee rights in Thailand, you know, because, and then they have the outcome that many people who cross the border become undocumented. And once I talked with some of government officers, I say why you not recognize refugees the refugees norm, international norm. No? But they say they're very afraid, very scared of the strong pull factor. If they accept this norm, many people will coming from many, many places to Thailand, and they could not hold these situations. And then once I also talking with the, some local authorities, no? And then I would like to know like how they define the word refugees. And then they have two definitions in Thai, but I cannot remember exactly what is exactly definition from government, from local authorities. Now they say that the Myanmar refugees from 1988 is like people who fleeing from wars. Now the first one, that's why they're living in the camp for like over 30 years. And second, on the refugee Myanmar refugee on 2021st. The local authorities say that those people are people who seeking temporary shelters for safety. So it means according to this term, so government is like have to fought them back after 72 hours. Like, excuse me, they can cross the border to Thai side, not over than 72 hours, and then they have to go back Myanmar side. And Thai government do not allow international to involve with this camp at all. They do not. And then no one can access to the temporary camps, you know, so no one can go inside to help Thai government or go to see what happened inside. But, you know, in some cases that if women, children, on person who are in dangerous conditions, so they can cross the border to go hospital, but still temporarily and going back to Thai sites. This is what I get from the my analysis now. And then for the next sections, we have so many questions like Professor Ladita mentions about the role of government. My question is like, I don't understand about the relationship between two government, but what we heard that they have a really good relationship among each other. And we don't know even how Thai government defies CDM. Are they undocumented? Are they refugees? Uncertainties, it means there can be anything. They can be, our government can define them as undocumented and can do whatever to them. And, you know, I saw some, like one government officers was going to the international conference. They were saying that it's like, everyone have to work with Myanmar government for peace. Our question is still, how that is like Myanmar is the one who violates human rights, and then how we can make peace with them as the key actors, and the government still like emphasize the role of ASEAN. It's like still emphasize what we mentioned before. It's like about the five key of ASEAN, the consensus of ASEAN. But how it's like they just for me they just declaration, you know, and then. They don't have the clear like action what to do. Okay, let's go for the good thing. It's like what I get with when we talk with Thai Red Cross, you know, it's like Thai Red Cross also provides the vaccine to the people in the camp, but only in Thai side. And then we still have the good relationship with the Thai Red Cross to do humanitarian working in Thailand side. But we're not sure. It's like we heard it from Thai government again. It's like Thai Red Cross also work with Myanmar government for humanitarian assistance, but we don't know how they're working together, you know. And then because of this, those situation, it's local NGO is like still they become the key actor to support the humanitarian assistance to another side, but they have to work in low profile because government do not want like any action to be published on the news. Some NGO can work with low profile, now they can distribute the cost. And then, yeah, let's go next. Yeah, some you can see many donations from overseas Myanmar migrant workers, and then local NGO is one who take an action to help IDP and refugees normally. It's like summary what really happened. Okay.
Oh, one question. How can like a Thai person like myself or probably the listeners or the participants joining us, how can a Thai person like us help Myanmar refugees?
Okay. Have you answered based on NGO perspective now? Because I think we're really small. We are just NGO, local NGO, and work just day by day and really limited resources. For me, the short term, what we can do, we just, at least we could not let people die in front of us. You know, we just can support them, like humanitarian support, like food and donations. Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's all I can think about what really happened now. And another thing is like on the educations, what I see is like now many students want to apply for the non-formal education system. And what I talk with my friend in Borders, they really lack of like the teachers volunteer, you know. If you can be volunteer, they can go to help them to provide education for the student at the Borders. And but some case is like they also have online education, no? Maybe I think we can link together and then yeah, just to be volunteer to provide education for a student. And then what else? And then I don't know, I just thinking on NGO perspective, we cannot do much, you know, we're not policy making, we could not even force my government to do those things. But this thing really happened on the borders, people suffering every day. So as you're working on humanitarian support, it's like you could not ignore that.
But if you, I'm running a page called Natty in Myanmar. I have about 58,000 followers right now who are interested in Myanmar issues. So if I can be a platform for you to help spread the words, please feel free to send me the details. What you need so I can help spread the words in terms of, you know, how like, as a Thai person, we can, you know, like donate food or maybe spread the news about what's going on at the border. So we that way that we can help, like myself or my followers can help.
Nothing, I have one more point, you know, actually once I talked with some friend, you know, at IDP camp, actually they also have artwork inside the camp. And then we're just thinking how we can link like those students to the group. It's like, I'm not sure if they can do some like artwork and then they can sell in the artwork in Thai side or in social media, international communities, you know, because it's so difficult situation, you know, people living in the camp, they cannot come outside. So how we can link them to the like global communities. Okay. How they can make money by themselves.
Think we can that later on after today's discussions and then how we can help them. I think there's something about like something like NFT, that's something that we can look at. I think people can sell their arts anywhere in the world through NFTs, and there also at some other platforms as well. I think we can discuss in details after the discussions. I'm happy, like my page, I'm happy to help if I can help, you know, with any projects of yours. You're welcome. Next, Godette, how important is this international solidarity for you?
The international solidarity is very important for us because, you know, since the group started, you know, many of the international solidarity movement also have started, including the MIGTI Alliance. So it has been up and running since, you know, since the group started, it's been already over 1 year. And also there are many international solidarity movements around the world. So that is very important for us that the people around the world not to forget about our struggle and movement, because the people inside the country, you know, we are struggling a lot. You know, we are, of course, at first, you know, we were like expecting that UN were intervening or the US were intervening, you know, to stop all the atrocities. So many people expected and many people, you know, like demanded, you know, even to the UN, you know, there were a lot of protests in front of the UN and a lot of, you know, demands and requests to the UN, you know, to come and stop it. But unfortunately, we all realized later that, you know, that no one can save us. We are our own savior, that we all realize. But we still need the solidarity support, you know, around the world. Because, you know, because of this kind of support, we have seen, you know, remember that, you know, that we are not alone, and you know, and that we are not only the people that have been this kind of, you know, difficulties, you know, and atrocities by the government. So the international movements are very important, and also especially for this time. Yeah, my Ajahn also, you know, explained about the ASEAN 5-point consensus. Actually, that is useless. You know, they can't do anything. You know, even for the humanitarian corridor, you know, there is no effort for it. Like for very little, you know, things that, you know, that the ASEAN 5-point consensus, you know, can achieve. So these things need to make it again. And also, we have to remember that ASEAN 5-point consensus is actually dragging the situation back to under the 2008 constitution, because they only intend that the situation to be back to the situation before the coup. So it means that we will be still under the 2008 constitution, which is really totally undemocratic constitution. So we have to make a change. And that is also not the goal of our Supreme Revolution at all. You know, we cannot share power with the military anymore. Of course, like we are, you know, very strong, you know, I mean, you know, strong determination in this time that, you know, we have been dealing with the military for many years. And for the past 5 years, you know, when the NLD government was in the power, you know, they tried to deal with the military, and you know, the military is still, you know, taking upper hand. So the constitution itself is already, you know, framed that military to get in the upper hand. So we don't want to let it happen again anymore. And that is actually the vision of the revolution as well. So I think, you know, the world should realize that. So I do understand that, you know, the international community, like, you know, don't want to, you know, to make, you know, more problematic, you know, situation, you know, in this. That is why they're trying to make a dialogue. Of course, we know that, you know, that this conflict, every conflict has to be ended up, you know, to be ended up on the dialogue table. But, you know, our dialogue will only happen when our revolutionary group are getting upper hand. So without that, we will not, you know, kneel down, you know, before them. And also we need to be aware of the next year elections that they are preparing, and we cannot let it happen. And also the international communities and international organizations should be aware that the military hunters, the military group right now, they are not the government of Myanmar. That is very important. So none of the Myanmar people recognize them as the government. So we don't want the international community to recognize them as the government or as the governing body of the country. So that is very important. And for the elections, as I said before, that, you know, they are taking all of the, you know, preparation, you know, to make it happen. And they will try to release, you know, some of the political prisoners, and then they will try to play some politics, you know, to get the recognition from the international community. So I think the some of the global power holders roles are very crucial at this point. You know, if they recognize it, you know, as the, you know, elections, then that will also be a problem. And also another challenge is the credential challenge that our representative in the UN right now, then there will also be another challenge for us, because last year, you know, we still got our representative in the UN, but, you know, for the coming years, then there is also a huge challenge. So we still need a lot of international support, you know, to be, especially for the NUG. Of course, NUG has a lot of weaknesses, you know, as a revolutionary government. But you know, this is like one of the solidified body of you know of all of the ethnic groups all together. But you know, NUG itself has a lot of things need to be changed, like you know their policies, you know, especially for the Rohingya people and especially for the ethnic minorities as well. That you know, the NUG they already have the Rohingya policy, but they haven't implemented anything yet. But that is very important, and also. The you know the revolution our revolution right now is not just you know to fight back to the Burmese military but also to lay down the foundation of the fundamental values of the for the new societies as well the our revolutionary government at the NUG so they are now talking about the federal democracy. So they need to, you know, really practice in the, you know, federalism, you know, among themselves. So I mean, you know, for the international community, if like for the, you know, they need to talk to the NUG, you know, to be more aware about it and then to be really, you know, getting in line with what they have said, you know, in their principles. And also, you know, many of the actors know of the international community know that NUG and CRPH. But there is also one important, you know, body called NUCC. This is like if the full name is the National Unity Consultative Council. It includes, you know, five different pillars, you know, that including the elected bodies, elected members, and EROs, the ethnic revolutionary organizations, and Supreme Revolution organizations like civil societies and the protest organizations and like political parties and also what else wait let me check the another one is that hold on it's like the interim council of the ethnic groups so like this is the these are the pillars of the NUCC. So actually, the NUG itself is you know founded by the NUCC. So it is already declared in the charter that NUG is founded by the NUCC. And then behind that NUG, the NUCC have you know all of the you know majority of the you know ethnic revolutionary organizations involved. In the NUCC, and they are making the policies of the NUG, and then they are making the strategy of the revolution. So NUCC is also one of the, I mean, you know, the important player of the revolution. So I think you know they should also be more engaged with the NUCC for the political for the policy matters as well. Yeah, and. Especially 55, like you know, I'm talking with the you know, with the Thai friends that you know what we need from the Thai community is that we need the civil society, I mean people to people engagement more. You know, since many of the activists and politicians are in Thailand side, you know, there should be more engagement among us, and then there should be more understanding. Each other, because you know the many newcomers in the Thailand, you know, feel like you know they don't really know about you know they only have had a little bit about the Thai politics, but they don't know in detail. And they don't know how the Thai you know activists or Thai civil societies can you know work together you know for the betterment of the situation, at least for the humanitarian support, or at least for the people who are living in the border cities. So like, that will also be. Be a big you know a support for us as well, and also we can you know from that communication we can reach to the region and movement as well, like you know ASEAN movement you know together with Thai and Myanmar activists or civil societies that you know we can make it all together, and also the our Myanmar problem you know the Burmese conflict is not just our our national conflict. This is actually a regional conflict. So like, especially Thailand right now is affecting, you know, of the conflict. And also, you know, our neighboring, another neighboring, the India, like kind of the Mizoram state. So they are also, you know, having, you know, this kind of thing. And also the Rohingya case, the Bangladesh is, you know, affecting. So this is actually a regional matter. So if we cannot, you know, since we cannot rely on our regional government, we all know that our governments are useless. You know, they are only, you know, holding, you know, hand in hand each other, you know, to protect each other. Only a few of the ASEAN governments are, you know, really standing up, you know, for that, for the human rights and democracy. So since our government are not there for us, then we should be there for us each other. You know, we only have X, you know, so we really are looking forward from our, to work together with our Thai friends and, you know, Thai communities that were, and also, you know, I would also like to make, you know, give a message to the Thai people from here that, that we are here to take refuge. We are not here to make any problems to the Thai community. And then we are just here to take refuge and, you know, like making a friend with the Thai people. And we are looking support from the Thai people for our democratization. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. It's very useful. And yes, thank you so much. And now we would like to move on to the questions. We have several questions coming in already. The first question is, currently there are many Myanmar students, activists, or academics who fled to Myanmar and Thailand border, and some of them are waiting to move to another country or to get a permit from Thai government to leave legally. And what suggestions do you want to give to the Thai government? May I please start with Khun Don Ka?
Hello, okay. Regarding to the refugees cases, no, I think Thailand have nothing to do to host refugees in their countries. So actually there are still some, clearly, no, there's still some people apply for refugees and going to the third country. But it's really like low, like small numbers. It's like many people apply and take so long. And then I don't know how much exactly numbers going there, just only 100. But you know, this problem is like, causes to about 100,000 people. For me, it's like Thai government have to consider another solutions, not even let everything going like this, you know? As long as we're talking with many people along the borders, even people in the camp, CDM people, you know, they just only have simple thing they really want to get from the Thai government and Thai people, like, simple things, they just want to work legally. Like they just want to government allow them to work and then they want to sustain their life, you know. They don't want to asking for donations all the time and getting trouble with the Thai authorities. Yeah, I think this very simple questions. Yeah, simple okay. Answer, sorry, simple answer. So.
Okay, thank you. Ajahn Lalita, may I please have also the answer from you? What suggestions do you want to give to the Thai government in terms of handling, you know, the Myanmar refugees?
I once asked a retired Thai ambassador. He wasn't in Myanmar, by the way, but he was somewhere else in Europe and in Asia. And I asked him simply this question, what is the real objective of Thai diplomacy towards Myanmar? Mm-hmm. And he said to me, look, there is no real diplomacy in this world for Thailand. There is no real direction. You know, we just go with the flow. We just go with whatever is in front of us. we just go with the wave. And that's what he said. And I listened to another senior journalist talking to me the other day, trying to defend the Ministry of Foreign Affairs and the Thai government by claiming that by having like 2,400 kilometers something shared boundaries between Thailand and Myanmar, of course, Thailand is in the kind of situation that is more tricky than other countries in ASEAN. Mm-hmm. And you know, I've been told quite a lot about this when I asked some, you know, some army officers or some people who have something to do with Myanmar, and they kept saying exactly the same thing, that you know, other countries in ASEAN, they cannot do what Thailand do, because they don't have the same situation, and they don't mm-hmm. even have shared boundaries with Myanmar. But I don't know. I think if Thailand wants to stand tall, you know, and be a part of the international community, it's very, very important to, you know, to be firm and to be assertive, saying things like, hey, we think that human rights is very important. We think that there is a human rights violation in Myanmar. And yeah, and I think that the Thai government should have more courage to criticize the Myanmar junta. But again, you know, I talked about what the Thai government thinks are their restrictions before. But in my opinion, Thailand can play a little bit smarter. You know, we have Singapore, we have Malaysia, we even have Indonesia, who have made it very clear that what's happening in Myanmar now isn't right. And ASEAN has to do something, has to push their agenda towards the Myanmar junta more firmly. But Thailand, on the other hand, we try to be silent. We try, you know, we just want to be bystanders. We don't really want to be a part of this whole discussion on the crisis in Myanmar. And I think that if you want to be a prestigious member of ASEAN, the ASEAN community, this needs to change. And you have to be Thailand has to be firmer in the belief that, you know, this violence needs to stop, and they can tell, and they can, you know, give advice to the Myanmar junta that, hey, this has to stop.
Thank you so much. And next questions. After the coup on the 1st of February 2021 until now, has there been a development project on the area of Salween River or Salawin, such as the Taji Dam? And how are the villagers in the area? I'm not sure if any one of the speaker could help answer this question, please. Okay, I think, is there any speaker who would like to answer?
I can answer the second questions, but the first one, I'm not sure. I think some of our friend working on that, no, about our investment, and then they quite have a lot of information along the borders, but I'm so sorry. I just working on refugees and many humanitarians work on the borders, no? For the food, inside the IDP camp. Actually, we keep contact with the friend in IDP camp all the time. You know, it's quite, they suffer a lot, you know, because it's not easy for them to get food even from Thai side right now. And they try to survive by themselves to pending the plantation for the plantations. There's a way asking us, you know, for giving them the seed, because mm-hmm. seed is quite small, nah? Small stuff, right? And then it's easy to crossing the border there. We just provide them the seed. And then our friends, like anyone who living on the hills, I mean, on the top of the mountains, there are lake of waters over there, you know? So we heard many times, like they have problem on the waters. But right now we keep in touch with them. They say during the raining seasons, you know, they get much the food, waters, and then if can supply for the plantations. You can see it's like really hard situations. They have to rely on, you know, it's uncertainties. It's like, I don't know how to say that, but yeah. Again, what we can do is just support them from distributing to IDP side.
Okay, thank you. I think the next question is, there is no hope from ASEAN who would be the key actors that can play a strong role for pushing the situation any better? Any speaker would like to answer this question, please?
I would say no one. Because You see, as ASEAN, it's always been a community. And the reason why ASEAN exists at all is because they want their voice. Each country wants their voice to be heard more loudly. And if you're alone in the world, nobody's gonna hear you. But if you become 10 countries, you become AEC or ASEAN, whatever, everyone would care about you. Everyone would be interested in joining you. As a community, I just don't think that ASEAN or any country at all would, play this Myanmar agenda alone. I think that Thailand has something in mind. And right now, I don't think that Thailand wants to go along or go along with what ASEAN, like Malaysia or Singapore try to push. But in the end, ASEAN is a community. It's a big community of 10 countries. Of course, there are some countries that just don't pay too much attention to Myanmar, like Laos or Vietnam, because they're so far away from Myanmar. And they don't have so much conflict with conflict of interest with Myanmar. But as I said before, Thailand is in an interesting point because we have a lot of kilometers that we share with Myanmar. And if someone at all can do something about Myanmar, can say something about what's happening in Myanmar, I think that would be Thailand. But the weakness here is that the Thai government is not really going to say anything. Do we expect them to talk about human rights when the Thai government, keeps breaking human rights every single day in Thailand? You see, that wouldn't make sense to me. Just to conclude the question, no, I don't think that anyone in ASEAN could play the most significant role in the struggle to end violence in Myanmar, but ASEAN has to be, a solid force of many countries together to push this agenda forward.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Last but not least, last questions.
Can I answer the last question as well?
Yes.
Yeah, I want to share now. I think. Like Professor Lalita says, now we have no hope on the governments at all. So, but I still positive that it's like what I have seen that people even from Myanmar and in Thailand, they really progress a lot on the term when they understand human rights and democracy. For me, it's like the key actor now is the people. It's like I don't know how to say that. It's like what I'm seeing, people really progress than governments. So. At least we have to be like what Ted say, we have to be unite first, and then we have to, even we have some problem with government, but in the term of people, we have to be unite and speak and work together and help each other as much as we can. And then I would like to share something, once I talk with some NUG governments, some deputies, it's like I asking them about the human rights international mechanism. It's like, it seemed like will support, submit the report to the UN about the situation in Myanmar? They say they will submit the report to UN in term of government, not in term of civil societies. That's quite challenging me, It's like, I just thinking that it's like now NUG try to challenge the all international state about the appearance of the governments. It seems like NUG's all junta government, it's like NUG challenged the UN all the time about who will be representative of the Myanmar in the UN. So for me, it's like, at least we have to support this kind of action as well, not even people, but or any actions related to human rights, democracies, and then like, anything to move on. Okay, thank you.
Thank you so much, Khun Don Ka. last round of the day before we ask for the participation from our participants. So I would like all the speakers to maybe give a few words on, you know, the suggestions or the solutions for the ongoing crisis in Myanmar. We start with Gotet. Gotet, please.
Okay, I just would like to add a few things. Our case, I mean, you know, like many people who fled to Thailand, our case right now is like quite similar to the case of Rohingya people. But, you know, Rohingya people got worse situation than us, much, much worse than us. But, you know, many people here, I mean, especially, you know, those MPs and those, you know, politicians and to those, you know, many other people who denied the Rohingya people. So they all are now in the similar situation as the Rohingya people, like the Thailanders. It is very, you know, hard situation for all of us that, you know, being a statelessness is really, really hard, you know. Like I can even feel that, you know, when I crossed the river, you know, just one river crossing, then everything changed. And then I became an illegal person. And, you know, I have no right, you know, as a person that, you know, all the basic rights, already, you know, a big challenge for all of us. You know, this is like when lesson learned that, you know, that the all of the people who denied the rights of the Rohingya people, you know, back in the Burma. And also, you know, the boundaries, the state boundaries, they are really, you know, questionable to me. Like this is just my personal thought, you know, the state boundaries, you know, why we became illegal, we just crossed the river, like, you know. So all the national boundaries, they are really a big, you know, obstacles, you know, for rights of everyone. I mean, you know, so we should all have the basic, you know, human rights and all the fundamental rights, you know, of everyone. So that is like, that's my personal thought that I just want to share you guys. And like, you know, for me, like I always share to my friends, you know, whoever, you know, came to this small town where I'm living right now, that, you know, I always welcome them, seeing them that welcome to the zoo. But this is actually like a zoo for us that we cannot get out of this town. You know, we are just living here. We got like somehow good food and, you know, like, you know, a good life here that, you know, we can live safely than, you know, in living in Burma. And then we got a good food and good internet that we can connect with the whole world. But, you know, we cannot go anywhere. We are just living here. If we get out of this town, we'll be arrested. That we need a lot of, you know, documentation and requirements, you know, to go to the other place. And even for the healthcare, a friend of mine, he got a very severe back injury that he needs to do the MRI, the MRI scan, but he can't do it here. He needs to go to another town. But, you know, when we request to the local authority, that they denied. And then when we approached the UN, they said they can't do it. Like no one could help him, you know, to get the health care, you know, even for the basic health check, you know, for his back pain. So many people got a lot of problems, you know, of being statelessness. Then, you know, we can now sympathize the situation of the Rohingya people, but their situation is much, you know, like, you know, worse than us. But, you know, even just a little bit of the feeling, it really make us feel bad and hurt. And also my message to the world is that, you know, sometimes like, I saw the media portray that, you know, Burma people already giving up the revolution and the military is like very powerful and they are winning. Actually, no. You know, like there are protests everywhere in the country every day. And they are fighting, you know, in the center of Burma and also many ethnic area. You know, people are resisting. People are defending ourselves every day. So, and our will never stopped. So this is what I want the whole world to know, that, you know, the sometimes the media portrayal is really important, that, you know, we are not losing, and we will not let them win us. That is my message to the world.
Thank you very much. And next we are moving to Khun Don. Would you like to share your suggestions or solutions for the ongoing crisis in Myanmar, or would you like to say your final remarks, please?
Yeah, I would say mentions about humanitarian support. You say it's quite slowly. I already mentioned about humanitarian support, no, to the people, even in refugees and in the IDPs camp. But what I want to add more is, like, we have to voice up to our governments, not even in Thai, but every government to say it is wrong thing to do. Even government doing nothing, but we cannot keep silent on that. We have to keep, like, knock the door all the time. And also, yeah, again, we have to knock the door of UN. Many people say that UN is, like, useless during these situations, but we could not silent again. We have to keep knock the door, asking, calling for the principle, international principles about peace. UN what established for peace, right? We have to knock their door, not left in silence. Even they doing nothing and doing really small things, we have to keep doing on that. And another thing is, like, I have to mention that even refugees, migrant workers, they are not the problem. I want to specifically talk to Thai people. Many Thai people say we have, like, the wrong perceptions that they are a problem. They come to doing some bad things in Thailand. They steal our job. But actually, those things we also have involved with the incidents. We also pass off the problem, you know. When we see they are problems, it's like when we see they are problem, it's like we still again suffer them, you know, by even mentals, even actions. And when any people, when we ignore about situations, it means we also support the junta. So at least I would like to emphasize that. It's like, this is our, how do I say, it is, we have to join hands together, no? And then this problem is like, we have to help each other based on, like, human rights, democracies, anything. So we cannot let me and my friend to fighting this thing alone. So at least, yeah, you know, yeah.
Thank you very much. Ajahn Lalita, your final remarks or your suggestions or solutions for the ongoing crisis in Myanmar?
I don't have any definite answer to this. I'm so sorry about this once again, because if I do, if somebody knows, you know, violence in Myanmar, in Burma, wouldn't drag on this long. But of course, clearly, there are only two solutions. This civil war will go on and on and on forever. And two, there needs to be sort of negotiation, you know, unless you're like a rebel group from Rwanda, the Tutsi rebel group that managed to win the Rwandan civil war, and they managed to occupy Kigali, the capital city of Rwanda, and ended the massacre, the civil war in Rwanda. I just don't think that is going to be the case with Myanmar, considering the size, the sheer size of the Tatmadaw, with, you know, hundreds of thousands of soldiers in their hand. Of course, you can say that soldiers are now deserting the military, but I'm quite sure that the Myanmar military will do whatever they can in that capacity to drag on and to continue this fighting. You know, I watched a sort of funny documentary about Nigerians the other day, and one Nigerian pointed out, and I find it quite interesting. There is a mindset that there is one kind of attitude and thinking among Nigerians that if you do something, you have to do the best. If you do something really bad, you have to be the worst. You have to do it. You have to make sure that it's the worst in the world, you know. And I think that that mentality also reflects what the military in Myanmar does at the moment. Like, for example, right now, the military in Myanmar, the junta, they cannot back off. You know, if they back off, they would lose everything, whatever they did before and after the coup. They would lose everything, that they would certainly lose the status quo. And that is something that they, you know, that they would never want to lose. The country would be broken into states, into federated states, like most people in Myanmar want right now. But I just don't think that the military wants that. You know, ethnic groups, ethnic communities would be broken, that there might be, you know, different countries like Karen country or Mon country, who knows. And that is something that the military never, ever wants at all. So in the future, I hope that there will be some sort of negotiation, even though I don't see any real and fruitful possibility just yet. But eventually, in order to end this violence, that there will definitely be, you know, a solid peace talk, not just ad hoc or, you know, a fake peace talk like before, where everyone really needs to focus and come into terms with each other and move forward as one country or one federated Myanmar, whatever. Yeah, so that would be the ultimate solution for me, but whether or not it's going to be possible, I absolutely have no idea.
Okay, understood. Okay. Ms. Roya, your final remark or your suggestion or solutions for the ongoing crisis in Myanmar, please.
Yes. So, I mean, obviously what we're seeing happening today has not happened in a vacuum, right? It's reflective of the pattern of decades long abuse by the military. But it's also reflective of the direct outcome of flagrant impunity. We've seen the military do these actions time and time and time again, and we've seen very little in the space of justice and accountability. And that is one of our main calls here. This is what happens when you see actions without any consequence. Speakers have spoken at length about the need for better international action, better pressure from ASEAN. Our main call in this report, or one of our key recommendations, are specifically to the UN Security Council. And what we are calling for is an absolute comprehensive arms embargo, including on the sale and transfer of military-grade aviation fuel. These are the kind of substantive actions that we're calling for that would enable us to see a semblance of, you know, actions by the international community to ensure the protection of civilians. There are other actions, of course, in the space of justice and accountability, including for the Security Council to refer the situation in Myanmar to the International Criminal Court, for countries and the Security Council to impose targeted financial sanctions against senior officials responsible for serious violations and crimes. I mean, in the report, for example, in this particular report, we were able to identify specific military units responsible for violations such as the 66th Light Infantry Division and others. And in previous report, we've named certain officials and individuals, and we've seen some actions taken by certain members of the international community in the space of sanctioning these individuals. But what we need to see is sustained action, because as the world's attention turned away from Myanmar, we saw the military able to carry out these brazen actions where the military confrontations and ceasefires across the country have broken, and you see a proliferation of these armed conflicts. And not just that, even at a time where they're carrying out such brazen war crimes and likely crimes against humanity, the world is not acting, the world is not responding. And then we see, as Kotet pointed out, further escalations such as the ability to threaten actually carrying out death penalties, actual executions, for the first time in what, in 30 years? So at a time when massive armed confrontations are happening, no international action in that space, they even are able to escalate further by threatening something like those horrific possible imminent executions. So all of this, in our opinion, in our analysis, is a direct outcome of this ongoing international inaction. And it solidifies and underscores our call for a need of sustained action from entities such as the United Nations Security Council, such as specific calls as the comprehensive arms embargo that we're calling for.
Thank you very much. I appreciate your answer, Roya, and of course your hard work and contributions on the report. And thank you very much, all the speakers. We have come to the last part of our today's discussions. I would like to open the floor for all our participants who would like to share a few words with us. If you would like to share a few words, please feel free to raise your hands, and our team from the Amnesties will be allowing you to share with us your thoughts. Please. Please feel free to click raise the hand.
Okay.
Okay.
Hello, I'm Chalida from People Empowerment Foundation. So I would like to add some information to fill in the gap of information. I have 5 points to share. The first one about the comparative between the coup of Myanmar, the first coup of Myanmar that did that during 1988, and then Dr. General Thein Sein not to be the prime minister and promised to have the election after that. And then they have elections after during 2019, and then Aung San Suu Kyi win the election 2 times. And then all of us who done the campaign for the Myanmar think that is now settled already for democracy in Myanmar. But 2021, they have been have another coup after the result of the election that Aung San Suu Kyi win more than 80 seats in the parliament. And that is a thing that the military cannot accept that. So that's why they have the coup again. So if we consider about this coup, you can see that there are a lot of protests of the Myanmar people continue protesting inside and outside. They also dedicate themselves, die or arrested, put in jail. There are right now 20,000 political prisoners in Myanmar. And you see many of CDM, PD, who cross border to fight resettlement and also safe space for them to live, because that is the protest of the CDM who don't want to support Myanmar military. So this is also show very strong point of the people who deny the Myanmar junta, military junta. And PDF, you also can see that there are so many PDF that join with ethnic armed group, not only in NUG group only, they have NLD group, they also have many ethnic Karen, Shan, AAA, no? PDF. So many of them that join with ethnic minority armed group in the jungle. So that is one way of the student, the same with the 6 October massacre in Thailand, that there are many students that join with Communist Party because they don't have any way to fight against the military. So the need of the people right now that they fighting for their democracy, that because they need federal state. They don't want election on 2013, that announcement by the government that they will come out with the election again. But people said, no, we don't want that. We want federal state. So right now, like Ted explained about NUCC, that doing some driving the constitution, federal constitution state and they are continuing on the consultation with many ethnic, with many political body. It's huge of the member of NUCC, you know? They are moving for their futures. So this is the role of the ethnic minority to build up the new futures of the countries that they are doing right now. They have some future, they have aim of themselves, you know, to move forward with that. And then for the Thai policy that many people also ask of it, Thai government is very bad on human rights. They don't understand about international standard. They don't understand about humanitarian support. They don't understand anything about international standard. They just do only G2G. Everything is government to government. However, we ask Thai government to receive vaccine 19 for the people along the Myanmar border and also for the IDP. They deny. They said that, do you consult with the Myanmar government, with military? If we consult with them, we did not get this vaccine. And we also didn't get the vaccine because Thai government did not allow us to do that because it should be consulted with the military on the time. And then when you don't also mention about Thai Red Cross, usually Thai Red Cross also will do as G2G. They must do with Myanmar Red Cross, and you can imagine what happened with the humanitarian aid through Red Cross, no? International Red Cross to Myanmar Red Cross. And AHA on ASEAN also doing something like humanitarian by government to government. So it means that people will not get any support from this kind of the mechanism and structure. The other point that there someone asked about white card. Usually they have white card and pink card. Pink card is for migrant worker that allow them to register, and they will get a pink card. They will extension every 2 years. For pink card, they not allow the people who hold that pink card to go outside the area that they're working and register. But for white card is a stateless person that is can develop to be a part of citizenship of Thailand. And 10 years for white cards is on, they can travel in many places, but however, they should ask permission from the authority, local authority to go out from the area. Right now for the CDM and also for PDF and CDM and also some people who living in some city, you know, border city, they have police guard, we call police guard, that they also use as one of the guard to protect them when they were arrested. They can also show this guard and then police will release them. That is just only mechanism that we have to protect our friend in the border right now. Next, about the solution, I think that very important to listen to the Myanmar people, what they want, not listen to international, sorry. You must listen to the Myanmar people, what they want. And right now they want federal state. They don't want peace talk. They don't want anything. They want federal state that they are working right now, drafting new constitution and then come out with another futures for their own. And for us right now, we should consider two things. First, emergency humanitarian support, like humanitarian thing, no? IDP, refugee, and also CDM. No? But for future, we should support NUCC. NUCC is bigger than NUG, no? Because they're composed of different factors of the society of Myanmar. And this group will lead us what they want. We should support NUCC. What they do, and we should listen to them, we support them, not international voice, we should support people, Myanmar voice. So for us that we are doing right now, like Ted also mentioned, we organize exchange program. We went to the border every month to Mesot and to Chiang Mai because they have many Myanmar friends also living in Mesot in Chiang Mai and Chiang Rai. So we brought media and media together to support each other, student to student support each other. And as I mentioned that there are unsilenced projects, that created by young generation of Thailand, the student who didn't go to school, who didn't go to the university. They also come out with unsilenced project to support friends in Myanmar because they want Thai people to understand about situation in Myanmar and they want to share information. Sorry if I say that some media, Thai media also have not correct information. So that why this group of the students, when they go with us to the border, they can see that it's really important to have the Thai projects to support Myanmar and come out with correct information to share with the Thai and also international organization to know what's going on inside Myanmar and what we should support them.
Thank you very much, Conchalita, for your useful information. Thank you so much, Ka.
Oh, and one thing about refugee policy, Thailand will not allow new refugee camp open in Thailand anymore because of 9 refugee camp along the Myanmar, Thai border, Myanmar cannot solve the problem yet. So that no new refugee camp in Thailand. But however, the local authority allow us to open IDP camp at the border. So many of the IDP camp right now is open at the border so that we can submit medicine, food, and some assistance to them by Thai authority that allow us, but it should be very low profile because if the Myanmar military know about this, they will be in trouble.
I'm so sorry to cut you off like this because of the limited time we have. And I would like to say thank you to all the speakers, all the participants who spare your time to spend with us during the webinar today. And I would like to also thank you, the Amnesty International Thailand, who organized such a wonderful event today. And also the Amnesty International always organize this kind of events and webinar and as well as some exclusive activities only for MSC members. And if you don't want to miss this kind of events, you can become MSC members. Now the MSC Thailand has special promotion. You can check the link in the chat box. And also for those of you who are interested in the reports can contact the MSC International Thailand to read the report by Ms. Roya and team as well. And that concludes today's discussions. And thank you so much, everyone. My name is Aurawi Thammi Sang, and have a good night.
Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, Kap. See you. Thank you so much.
Thank you, everyone.